extending the medical care and saving the souls with complete care. As we are gathered in her name today, we express our sincere thanks to all who have worked relentlessly and paved the way to make known the glories of life of Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart to the multitude. Gracious Lord, we implore your blessings upon everyone who is involved in this process of acknowledging the divinity of Dr. Sister Mary Glowrey. We do hope and pray that all our efforts and prayers may rise Dr. Sister Mary Glowrey soon in the company of saints in heaven, so that we have one more saint in the church for imitation and intercession. May everyone who enters her shrine experience healing power through her intercession. This prayer we make through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Most Reverend Dr. Galibali, Bishop Emeritus of Guntur, His Excellency Most Reverend Dr. Raja Rao, Bishop of Vijayawada, Reverend Father Erva Bala Shavradi, Episcopal Delegate, Monsignor Swarna Bernard, Promoter of Justice, Reverend Father Sliva Koya, CSSR Notary, Reverend Father Raphael Komaredi, Adjunct Notary, Reverend Sister Gnana Prabha, JMJ, Copyist, Reverend Sister Mary Karika Kunal, JMJ, Postulator, my dear fathers, sisters, and my dear people, we are gathered here together for the closing ceremony of the diocesan inquiry of the cause of beatification and canonization of the servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, a professed religious of the Society of Jesus, Mary and Joseph, the JMJ sisters, popularly known as Dr. Sister Mary Glowrey. As some of those present here are eyewitnesses, you yourself know about the life of Sister Mary Glowrey. Sister Mary Glowrey was born, brought up with Christian values under the guidance of the God-fearing parents in Australia. She completed her studies in medicine and was practicing as doctor when she received the call from his master to be a missionary in India. She came in the year 1920, leaving her most promising career as a doctor just with the thought of caring for the sick and needy. From the time she stepped into our land, she never returned but gave herself selflessly for 36 years to care for the poor and sick here in St. Joseph's Hospital, Guntur. Towards the end of her life, she suffered much and died in Bangalore in the year 1957. I feel it is very fitting that we complete the diocesan inquiry on this 60th anniversary of the death of Dr. Sister Mary Glowrey. It is the first time a diocesan inquiry for the cause of canonization has taken place in our diocese and whole of Andhra. I see that it's not an easy task, takes a long time and lot of procedures involved. I do appreciate all the persons work tirelessly during the first few years, especially after the opening ceremony of the diocesan phase on 29th October 2014, which was presided over by our beloved Bishop Emeritus His Excellency Dr. Galiwali. As far as I know, many persons were appointed, such as theological censors, historical commission, and the diocesan tribunal, to see that everything goes on according to the norms. And the postulator was working behind all this. All of them have sincerely worked hard to get the maximum truth regarding the person of Sister Mary Glowrey, persevere with strong determination, and today we see the concrete expression of this first step being completed. Since the time members of the tribunal were appointed to conduct the diocesan inquiry, they have interviewed witnesses and prepared their findings to be forwarded to the Congregation for the Causes of Saints in Rome. Today, the boxes which we find here in front of us are the fruit of their hard work. During these 2.5 years, many events took place. The theological census studied the published writings of the servant of God and submitted their report. The historical commission studied nearly 800 documents received from 27 archives, both in India and abroad, including Australia and Vatican, and submitted their report. Rogatory inquiry of hearing of the witnesses took place in the Archdiocese of Melbourne and Adelaide in Australia. The act of exhumation, identification and transfer of the mortal remains from Bangalore to Guntur, and today we are privileged to have a mortal remains in our midst. After having done such a great work within this short period, I think with all satisfaction, today the tribunal members are going to take the oath that they have done their task faithfully and will maintain the secret of office. In this session, the packages will be closed and sealed. The original copy will be kept in a safe place in the diocesan archives. The two packages with the copies will be sent to Rome for further procedures.
I, duly appointed promoter of justice of the diocesan inquiry in the cause of canonization of the servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, JMJ, also known as Dr. Mary Glowrey, hereby declare that I have examined these acts presented by the notary, Reverend Father Sliva Koya, and I hereby publicly declare that I have no objection regarding them.
In the name of His Excellency, Right Reverend Dr. Chinnabathini Bhagyaya, I accept officially the acts presented by the notary, Reverend Father Sliva Koya. Thank you, Monsignor Swarna Bernard, the promoter of justice, for having checked officially these numerous pages and declared your satisfaction. Now I hereby declare that these documents are authentic and present them officially to His Excellency Dr. Chinnabathini Bhagyaya, Bishop of Guntur. Your Excellency, your predecessor, His Excellency Right Reverend Dr. Galibali, initiated this diocesan inquiry on 29th October 2014 and appointed me Episcopal Delegate to conduct the inquiry with the help of a group of dedicated collaborators. He had been guiding us till Your Excellency took charge of the diocese on 8th September 2016. I have fulfilled the task assigned to me and I have the singular honor and the pleasant duty to present to you the acts of the diocesan inquiry. Here they are gathered in 6 passages of 3 sets, each set containing the depositions of witnesses heard by the tribunal in the diocese of Guntur and archdiocese of Hyderabad and Bangalore, and the English translation of what is done in Telugu. The acts of the rogatory inquiry in the Archdiocese of Melbourne and Adelaide in Australia, the acts of exhumation, identification of the mortal remains of the servant of God in Bangalore, and the transfer and entombing of the same in Guntur, and the report of the historical commission with typed copies of the handwritten documents and English translation of the documents in Dutch and Telugu languages. Your Excellency, the first set, the archetype, is destined for your diocesan archives, while 2 sets, the transcript and the public copy, are to be sent to the Congregation for the Causes of Saints, Rome.
Dr. Chinnabathini, Bishop of Guntur, place my hand on the Holy Bible and swear that from the time I have taken up the charge of the diocese, I have faithfully fulfilled my duties in the diocesan inquiry investigating the life, virtues and reputation of sanctity of servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, JMJ, Dr. Mary Glowrey.
I, Father Erva Balashevreddy, certify that His Excellency Bhagya Chinnabathini, Bishop of Guntur, took this oath in my presence and swore that he has faithfully fulfilled his duties in the diocesan inquiry.
I, Dr. Galibali, Bishop Emeritus of Guntur, place my hand on the Holy Bible and swear that I have faithfully fulfilled my duties in the diocesan inquiry investigating the life, virtues and reputation of sanctity of servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, JMJ, Dr. Mary Glowrey.
I, Father Erva Balashevreddy, certify that His Excellency Galibali, Bishop Emeritus of Guntur, who initiated the cause of canonization of the servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, JMJ, Dr. Mary Glowrey, took this oath in my presence and swore that he has faithfully fulfilled his duties in the diocesan inquiry.
Reverend Father Yeru.
I, Father Yeru Balashev Reddy, duly appointed Episcopal Delegate for the diocesan inquiry, place my hand on the Holy Bible and swear that I have faithfully fulfilled the assigned task as Episcopal Delegate of this inquiry, investigating the life, virtues and reputation of sanctity of the servant of God, Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, JMJ, Dr. Mary Glowrey.
I, Father Swarna Bernard, certify that Reverend Father Yeru Balashev Reddy, Episcopal Delegate, took this oath in my presence and swore that he has faithfully fulfilled his duties in the diocesan inquiry.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Save the kids you love.
us pray. O God, the Father of every gift, we confess that all we have and all comes down from you. Teach us to recognize the effects of your boundless care and to love you with a sincere heart and with all our strength through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first letter of St. Peter, chapter 5, verses 2 to 4, 10 to 11. To tend the flock of God that is in your charge, exercising the oversight not under compulsion but willingly, as God would have you do it, not for sordid gain but eagerly. Do not lord it over those in your charge, but be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will win the crown of glory that never fades away. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 5, verses 5 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven." The Holy Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The people of Israel moved on at the command of the Lord, and at his command they camped. Book of Numbers, chapter 9, verse 8. Your Excellency, Most Reverend Bhagia Channabatani, Reverend Fathers, Sisters, and my dear people, when Moses erected the tent of the Lord, a cloud came from heaven and covered it. And we read in this chapter, chapter 9 of book of Numbers, verses 15 onwards. The cloud covered it continually during the day, and at night it looked like fire. Whenever the cloud lifted from over the tent, the people of Israel took down their tents and continued their journey. And whenever the cloud stopped, there the people of Israel camped. The people remained in the camp as long as the cloud rested on the tent of the Lord. Even when the cloud happened to stay for many days above the tent of the Lord, the people of Israel performed the functions imposed on them by the Lord and did not move on. Sometimes the cloud over the tent of the Lord stayed there for 2 days, sometimes for a month, and also much longer time, maybe several months. At the Lord's command they camped, and at the Lord's command they moved on. This is the journey of the people of God to the promised land. The promised land is the final goal of their journey. And during this long journey, they had to camp in several places. And this camping, this resting, as the Lord commanded them, it may be a day or a two or for weeks or even for several months, during which time the Lord taught them and also educated them. And these camps on this long journey to the promised land are the short-term goals or also mid-term goals. Similarly, we started our journey almost 3 years ago at the command of the Lord. In this journey of the diocesan inquiry for the promotion of Dr. Mary Glowrey to sainthood. Our sainthood is our goal, and on this journey we have been camping at the Lord's command and we have been moving forward at His command. And today we are happy that we have reached, in a way, our midterm goal. And that is why we praise and thank the Lord for bringing us up to this point. And that is why I request all of you to give a big applause in praise and thanking the Lord for this great glory. The outer journey of the people of God to the promised land was also a symbol of the inner journey. We have made the outer journey for almost 3 years in this cause, in this inquiry. Now the Lord is asking us to camp here for a long time, and then to listen to him. To listen to him. Now at this stage, let us enter into the inner journey. So far, we have been busy with the outer journey. Now it is high time that we enter into inner journey of the holy people, of saints, and of all our lives. The saints and the holy people have revealed very little about what goes on in their interior life in relation to God and the people around. We have only certain glimpses. But in the Bible, chiefly in the letters of St. Paul, we have also clear messages, indications of this interior journey of the apostle. There are two powerful experiences in this inner journey. We can sum up all that goes on in the interior world of the holy people and also of all of us in a somewhat similar way, but a much more intense way in the holy people. Two powerful experiences. One is consolation of the soul, and the other is desolation of the soul. These are the two paradoxical experiences a Christian soul undergoes in relation to the Lord. Now, in the letter of St. Paul, in the second letter of St. Paul to Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 4 onwards, we see how Paul received consolation from the Lord and imparted the same consolation, a divine consolation, to the people. He received consolation from the Lord in the midst of his trials and difficulties, and with the same consolation he comforted or consoled many people. And that is what every one of us is expected to do. And there are three types of consolation which the soul receives from the Lord. Three types of consolation. The first one is intellectual consolation. The saints, the holy people, and we can well imagine Dr.Sr.Mary Glowrey had this intellectual consolation, which means interior clarity of what goes on in her relationship with the Lord, more clear vision of what they see in their dealings with the Lord, and also what goes on around them. And thus, from that clarity, interior clarity of things in relation to God and in relation to the people with whom they live, they receive a kind of consolation. And this consolation is really comforting. The second kind of consolation is called affective consolation. Affective consolation means the soul enjoys or experiences an immense interior joy in the Lord. Interior joy in the Lord. That joy is really inexplicable. Such is the experience of joy, and such is the affective consolation the saints, the holy people have, and we too can experience that. And the third type of consolation is called substantial consolation. The saints, when they lived on this earth, when they communed with the Lord in their intimate relationship, their soul was really touched by the Lord. The soul was deeply touched by the Lord. And the soul is deeply touched by the Lord in the midst of their trials and difficulties. They experience real consolation. That is what happens deep within one's soul. Such is the experience of consolation that we can take note of in the interior world of the holy people and the saints, and we too need to make that kind of inner journey. I'm sure Dr. Mary Glowrey has had such inner journey, enjoying, experiencing this kind of consolation, intellectual consolation, affective consolation, and also substantial consolation, deeply touched by the Lord. At the same time, the saints also had an experience of desolation, which is a kind of dark night of the soul, a dark night. One feels abandoned by God, a God who has been so close to you until now, disappears. You don't feel that he is any more near to you. The God of consolation is not seen anymore. There is a kind of torture in the darkness, dark night of the soul, torture of loneliness, and this torture is experienced by many, many saints when they lived on this earth. For example, Mother Teresa, in her own testimony, speaks of 10 long years of this torture, this loneliness, this aridity, this desolation, this disappearance of the Lord, this dark night. That is why, and in spite of this darkness, in spite of the absence of the Lord, she never ceased to love the Lord. That is why she said, My key to heaven is that I loved Jesus in the night. Doesn't mean that she was making some adoration in the night. Doesn't mean that. In this period of darkness, absence of the Lord, dryness, loneliness, torture, she never ceased to love. She loved the Lord all the more. So in this dark period, of her life, she loved the Lord much more. St. John of the Cross says there are three signs that show the beginning of this dark night in the holy people. All of them, almost all of them, had this experience of desolation, this abandonment, this loneliness, this dryness, and all this absence of the Lord. John of the Cross, a Spanish Carmelite saint, says there are three signs that show that you are entering into dark night. These three signs are, the first one, one loses the original delight and satisfaction what you used to have before. Now, you used to have more delight and satisfaction in your life, in your inner life, in your relation with God and with your people. Now suddenly you feel you have lost. No more happiness, no more delight, no more satisfaction in what you do. That is the beginning, the first sign. Another sign is that you begin to feel that you are going backwards rather than forwards. In your inner life, you begin to feel that you are going backwards rather than forwards. So that is another indication that you are entering into this dark night. And the third sign is that you feel that you are unable to return to the original way of your prayer life. You had a more intense prayer life before, but now you suddenly feel that you are unable to go back to that original state. So that is another sign that you are entering into this darkness. And this is the experience of the saints, of the holy people, and perhaps many Christians also in some little way have this kind of consolation and desolation. That is the inner life, the inner journey that every Christian is expected to make. Chiefly in times of desolation, aridity, dryness, loneliness, dissatisfaction, it should be all the more loving Jesus, longing for Him, as Mother Teresa says so clearly in her testimony. Now, this consolation and desolation can also be explained in a different way. That is called hide and seek of the Lord. Hide and seek. Devuni daagudam mootalu. Devuni daagudam mootalu. Mem chinnappudu gramallo daagudam mootalu aatalu aadevaadam. Nenu aadaru, meeru aadaru ledhu naaku teliyadu. దాగుడు మూత ఆట అంటే పిల్లలు నలుగురు ఐదు ఒకసారి కూడి ఒకతనికి కళ్ళకు గంత కట్టి తక్కిన నలుగురు చుట్టుపక్కల పోయి దాక్కోవటం. కళ్ళకు గంత కట్టి ఉంటుంది, పోయి దాక్కుంటారు తక్కిన వాళ్ళు. తర్వాత ఇతను ఆ గంత తీసేసి తన ఫ్రెండ్స్ నలుగురు ఎక్కడెక్కడ దాక్కున్నారో పోయి కనుక్కోవాలి. సో నలుగురు నాలుగు చోట్ల దాక్కొని ఉంటే, పోయి కనుగొంటే అతను గెలిచినట్టు. ఆ విధంగా దాక్కున్న వ్యక్తిని పోయి కనుగొని పట్టుకున్నప్పుడు కొంత ఆనందం, తృప్తి, అచీవ్మెంట్ అనేది కలుగుతుంది. ఇది అరేంజ్డ్ థింగ్ కాబట్టి పెద్దగా ఉండదు, ఇదొక ఆట. అలానే ఇన్ ఎ మచ్ మోర్ ఇంటెన్స్ వే, ఇన్ ది ఇంటీరియర్ వరల్డ్, హైడ్ అండ్ సీక్ బిట్వీన్ ద లార్డ్ అండ్ ద సోల్. ఇట్ ఈస్ వెరీ వెరీ ట్రూ. అండ్ వీ హ్యావ్ క్లియర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్స్ ఇన్ ద బైబుల్. ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్, ఇన్ ద బుక్ ఆఫ్ సాంగ్ ఆఫ్ సాంగ్స్ చాప్టర్ 3:1-4, హౌ ద లేడీ, ద బెలవడ్, లవ్స్ హర్ లవర్ ద లార్డ్. Originally, these poems were love songs, and when they were incorporated into the Bible with modifications, they were interpreted as original meaning, the love songs between God and the people of Israel. Now, St. Bernard of Clairvaux and St. John of the Cross give an allegorical interpretation, spiritual interpretation, in which allegorical type is one type and which is the right one. Allegorical interpretation, love between Jesus and the church, and love between Jesus and the Christian soul. That is the meaning. Now you see how the beloved, the lady soul, loves and longs for the Lord, the lover, who is hiding himself. Until now, he has been in close touch with her, intimate touch with her, that is consolation. Now suddenly he disappears, he is absent, he is hiding somewhere. The soul, the lady, the beloved doesn't know where he is hiding. And there you see longing, much more longing for the lover, for the Lord. Longing, restlessness, and kind of agony. Agony for losing the lover. And that is how the search begins. And the soul is on bed, the beloved is on bed and unable to sleep because her lover has disappeared. On my bed at night, I looked for the one my heart loves. I sought him but did not find him. I called him, but he did not answer. So I said, I will rise and go about the city, through the streets and the squares. I will seek the love of my heart. I sought him, but could not find him. I came upon the watchmen as they made their rounds of the city. Have you seen the love of my heart? She asked. Have you seen the love of my heart? As soon as I left them, I found the love of my heart. I held him and would not let him go till I had brought him to my mother's house, to the room of the one who conceived me. See, this is the longing of the soul. This is the period of desolation, hiding of the Lord, and the soul longing for the one who is hiding, who is away, who is absent. And by this kind of process, the love is much more heightened, more intense, more longing and coupled with agony. And when she finds the lover, there is the ecstasy which was not experienced before, the ecstasy. Such is the interior life of the saints when they lived on this earth. Saint Bernard of Clairvaux and Saint John of the Cross tell us this is the kind of experience that we need to have in our Christian life. And at the same time, Satan says, I will not leave you. I will not leave you. And that is why in the same book, in chapter 2, it is said, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards, for our vineyards are in flower. Christian soul, Christian life is compared to a vineyard. In the book of Isaiah chapter 5, we see how vineyard is the symbol of the Christian soul or Christian life. Now, the soul is in intimate relationship with the lover. The Satan cannot keep quiet, wants to disturb. So in the vineyard of their love, the Satan sends the foxes. Foxes. Satan is the big fox and she sends small foxes. That is why it is said, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards. For our vineyards are in flower. Now the foxes come to ruin the vineyard, ruin this intimacy, this love, this relationship and so on. And this is what happens in the lives of the saints, all holy people, in our own lives. Satan is there to disrupt, to spoil, destroy the vineyard of our life, which the Lord has cultivated in us. That is why that is also part of this desolation. They had to fight, and we have to fight against all these foxes. Catch them, it is said. Don't leave them. Otherwise they will destroy the whole vineyard. Catch them and throw them out. That is the message. How many little foxes are there? If you read the Gospel of Mark, Jesus asked the evil spirit, how many are you? One of us says, what is your name? Jesus asked the evil spirit, Gospel of Mark chapter 5. And the evil spirit says, my name is Legion, for we are many. Legion, that is the Roman army, is divided into legions. A legion means 6,000 soldiers. Satan says, my name is Legion, we are many. And so there are so many ways of tempting. And so on. So that is Legion of Mary. The word Legion, Legion of Mary comes from that Roman army language, Legion. So the saints had to fight against these legions or the little foxes, catch them firmly and throw them out so that their vineyard, their life, which is in flower, which is going to bear abundant fruit, may not be destroyed. Mother Teresa once had a dream, and in the dream she saw a vision. In the vision, she went to heaven, She was so happy, so happy. She was at the gate of heaven. She was about to enter into the gate. Then suddenly, Peter comes and stops her. "I want to go into heaven." Peter says, "No, you cannot come here. There are no slums here. Therefore, there is no place for you." So mother was so angry. "Peter, I am going back, but I will come back with more slums, and more people of my slums, and fill your heaven with these people." With these people. Maybe Sister Mary of the Sacred Heart, Dr. Mary Glowrey, will say to Peter, "I am going to come back with all the sick people with whom I have lived, whom I have treated, whom I have loved, whom I have met Jesus," and so on, "and fill your heaven with all the sick people." Let us pray that may happen one day. May God bless.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried, He descended into hell, on the third day He rose again from the dead, and He is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
brethren, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy Church.
Let us pray. For the gifts you have bestowed, O Lord, we offer you the sacrifice of praise, humbly begging that what you have conferred upon us in our unworthiness, we may give back to the glory of your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For although you have no need of our praise, yet our thanksgiving is itself your gift, since our praises add nothing to your greatness, but profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, O Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and ever eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May ye make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Anne, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Pope Francis, and Bhagaya, our Bishop, Bali, our Bishop Emeritus, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, with him, in him, in the Holy Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Let us pray to the Father in the words our Savior has given us. O Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Almighty Father, everlasting God, for having been pleased through no merit of mine, but of your great mercy alone, to feed me, a sinner and your unworthy servant, with the precious body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, which we have offered you in thanksgiving. Grant that, being strengthened by gifts of courage and joy, we may serve you more devoutly and be worthy of still further blessings through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you in His kindness and pour out saving wisdom upon you.
Amen.
May He nourish you always with the teachings of the faith and make you preserve in holy deeds.
Amen.
Amen.
May He turn your steps towards Himself and show you the path of charity and peace.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord. Praise Sister Mary Glowrey. Praise the Lord. Praise Sister Mary Glowrey. Praise Sister Mary Glowrey. Praise Sister Mary Glowrey.
Priyamaina Muthiyamai, Devunike Priyamaina Muthiyamai, Sister Mary. Australia. She is the first doctor nun in Guntur.
దేవుని చిత్తము నెరవేర్చుటలో భూమిలో వెలసినాని ముఖ్యమై
తల్లి తండ్రిని తానొప్పించి వైద్య వృత్తిని తానెంచుకొని
పేదల పాలిటి పెన్నిదిగా దేవుని భక్తి ఊపిరిగా సేవ గురదే కంటి చూపుగా ఎంచిన సిస్టర్ మేరీ గ్లోరీ మేరీ గ్లోరీ పేదల పాలికి పెన్నిధిగా దేవుని భక్తి ఊపిరిగా సేవ గురమే కంటి చూపుగా ఎంచిన సిస్టర్ మేరీ గ్లోరీ
ప్రసాద వనముల స్వీకరించిన ఆలంబనతో
అనుదిన సేవకు అంకితమయ్యేను ఆద్రత భావం కలిగి ఉండెను
పెంచి పిలిచెను, ఆప్యాయతను పెంచి పిలిచెను. మేరీ గ్లోరీ సీక్రెట్ హార్ట్
మందిరమని తలచ నుంచి దేవుడితో సహవాసము చేసి మందిరమని తలచి దేవునితో సహవాసము చేసి
ఆనందామృత వర్షినిగా ఆలయ ప్రాంగణ దర్శినిగా
గెలిచిన నారి మనమేలి పిలిచిన ప్రతిసారి శ్రమనోరి గెలిచిన నారి మనమేలి
పిలిచిన ప్రతిసారి శ్రమనోరి
గెలిచిన నారి మనమేలి పిలిచిన ప్రతిసారి శ్రమనోరి బిషప్ ఆహ్వానంతో భరత ఖండాన కాలును మోపి కదమై గుంటూరునకు చూసి
హాస్పిటల్ నవ నిర్మాత నవ నిర్మాత నవ నిర్మాత
కదమై గుంటూరునకు చూసి హాస్పిటల్ రోగుల కొరకు
servant of God.
Sister Mary's mission of thought taught us to be pure and kind. Sister Mary's mission of thought taught us to be pure and kind. JMJ World is proud to say Dr. Nun, all are saying her sacred heart on the earth. Today we all aspiring her, heavenly saint to heavenly saint to heavenly saint to heavenly saint to. To the people of this world, the Master made her all in one. To the people of this world, the Master made her all in one. All in one, all in one, all in one. She, Sister Mary Glowrey, Mary Glowrey, Mary Glowrey. Soon she may be recognized as a saint of holy church.
Sister Mary Glowrey, aasayaya kunandi paliki. Aatalini spurti gagai kuni. Pragati padamu.
The staff and the students, once again, a big thanks to everyone.